Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Wondering About the Bible with Children, Engaging a Child's Curiosity About the Bible by Elizabeth Caldwell. Narrated by Ann Richardson. Introduction. Children participate in church educational programs and learn many Bible stories. They possess a lot of factual knowledge about Moses and Miriam, Abraham and Sarah, David, the stories of Jesus and the people he met, and the beginnings of the church that are told in Acts and the Epistles. Such learning is an important building block in their spiritual formation. The chance to wonder about the Bible as they wander through their life is essential for children's spiritual formation and for developing a language of faith. Like us, children have very important questions about biblical texts, the variety of faith expressions they experience in congregations, and the comments other children make to them, as well as the ones they overhear from us. Equally important is the chance for them to ask their own questions about biblical texts, to wonder about the story, to reflect on how they understand, and to interpret it and the meaning it has for their life. This chance for children to engage the Bible with all their curiosity and questions as they wander through their life is essential for their spiritual formation and for their development of a language of faith. It is incomplete if it only happens in the church. As good as such ministries are, they are insufficient unless supported by parents and families at home. Contemporary challenges. For more than 100 years, parents have relied on the church school, church education programs like Sunday school and midweek youth programming, to help their children learn the stories of the faith that are an important foundation for their spiritual formation. A primary method of teaching and learning has been to tell a repeating group of stories from the Old and New Testament, and then help children connect with those stories through art, music, drama, puzzles, even cooking and computers. Children learn the content of the stories, but often don't have the chance to engage with them in ways that help them deal with interpretation of texts or understand how the story relates to them and their life of faith. It's no wonder that a child in the fourth grade who hears the story of Jonah and the whale for the fourth time will say, "I know that story. I've heard it before." The children in our spiritual care need a way to engage the Bible that will grow with them. They need to have a biblical toolkit that will help them as they bring their questions, the things they wonder about, to the Bible. They need to have a spiritual foundation with the Bible that is grounded at home, as well as in the church. Focus of this book. This book is a revised edition of I Wonder, Engaging a Child's Curiosity About the Bible. It has been written to accompany the Celebrate Wonder curriculum and serve as a resource for educational leaders in the congregation, supporting teachers as they help children learn new ways of reading and interpreting Bible texts, will hopefully enable them to experience the Bible as both accessible and relevant to their lives of faith. Chapter 1 asks the question, what story does the Bible tell? It invites those who want to read the Bible with children to consider why and how we do that. Chapter 2 addresses the topic of how we can utilize children's natural curiosity when reading the Bible. In Chapter 3, readers are invited to explore a wondering model of reading that supports children's spiritual formation. Chapter 4 examines how we bridge the gap between what clergy and educators have figured out about the Bible and its interpretation, and how that knowledge and experience can be made available to parents of children. The last chapter offers ways to support families at home as parents and children grow in their lives of faith. Enabling a child's spiritual growth is a daily opportunity. In making it more intentional and connected with daily living, adults also grow as faithful Christians. The approach to engaging the Bible used in this book invites the reader to use soft eyes an expression taken from Aikido, the Japanese art of self-defense. In Aikido, a person's eyes are said to react in one of two ways when the person is taken by surprise. A hard eye narrows vision, shutting out the periphery so as to respond to the perceived fight or fear. Soft eyes open wide the periphery so that a person can take in more of the world. With soft eyes, you have whole vision, not partial. So instead of responding to a threat or to the world with a narrowed tunnel vision, soft eyes enable a person to see wider. Educator Parker Palmer has written about this concept in The Courage to Teach, Exploring the Inner Landscape of a Teacher's Life. Soft eyes, it seems to me, is an evocative image for what happens when we gaze on sacred reality. Now our eyes are open and receptive, able to take in the greatness of the world and the grace of great things. Eyes wide with wonder, we no longer need to resist or run when taken by surprise. Now we can open ourselves to the great mystery. How we read and interpret the Bible with children may mean the difference between whether or not the Bible will continue to be an important source for their life of faith as they become young adults. Do we read it in fear, afraid of what is there and what children might think and what questions they may ask us about it? Does our own fear keep us from opening our eyes wide with softness to the possibilities for hearing and seeing God's activity in the past with God's people and even today with all those whom God loves? Teaching children how to read and interpret the Bible in ways that they don't have to unlearn later is essential. Remembering to read the Bible, wondering about the stories, and inviting children to engage with their questions and imagination will contribute to their faith formation. This book is a resource for adults, parents, caregivers, pastors, educators, church school teachers, who want to help children read, engage, and wrestle with the Bible honestly, directly, and faithfully. This book will also be a resource for those who come to the Bible with souls open to be fed, and those who want to grow with children in their biblical and theological wisdom. Chapter 1. What story does the Bible tell? When I write for children about the spiritual, I strive to create such stories that use language in ways that are clear, filled with metaphor and symbolic images, concrete, and personally relevant to children's experiences, and open to ongoing questions and conversations. I imagine that these kinds of narratives have the capacity to help our youth and children grow up. Whether or not they are literally true, good stories have the power to help us better understand who we are and what we believe. Rabbi Sandy Eisenberg Sasso. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. This familiar childhood song reminds us of a basic theological concept. It's in the gospel stories where we first hear and learn about Jesus. Moreover, we learn about love as it is first experienced at home in relationship with family members. We connect the love spoken about by Jesus with our experiences of being loved by those around us. Beyond singing this beloved song with its simple affirmation of faith, what else are children learning about the Bible? Our hopes in keeping Bible stories alive with our children. From 2002 to 2005, the National Study of Youth and Religion interviewed more than 3,000 American teenagers, ages 13 to 17, and found that a majority of youth reflect the religious faith of their parents. In this study, Christian Smith and Melinda Lundquist Denton discovered that mainline Protestant youth who attended church with their parents were among the least religiously articulate of all teens. They found that the youth they interviewed were inarticulate with regard to speaking about their faith because no one had taught them how to talk about their faith or provided opportunities to practice using a faith vocabulary. A faith vocabulary is first shared and practiced at home as parents and other family members raise a child in the Christian faith. Reading the Bible and becoming familiar with its stories and the themes that are woven throughout its books is one of the most important ways for children to learn a vocabulary of faith. Reading the Bible is one of the most important ways for children to learn a vocabulary of faith. In their reflection on the National Study of Youth and Religion and its implications for the religious lives of teenagers, Smith and Denton identified several conclusions that are important for our thinking about the role of parents in the religious formation of their children. They found that parents have the most influence in the religious and spiritual formation of their teenage children. The best social predictor, although not a guarantee, of what the religious and spiritual lives of youth will look like is what the religious and spiritual lives of their parents do look like. Parents will most likely get what they are. A second important conclusion from the study is finding that many U.S. teenagers have a very difficult time articulating what they believe or the ways their belief systems impact their daily lives. Religion seems very much a part of the lives of many U.S. teenagers, but for most of them, it is in ways that seem quite unfocused, implicit, in the background, just part of the furniture, important but not a priority, valued but not much invested in, praised but not very describable. In this book that focuses on how we read the Bible with children, these conclusions about teenagers are worth remembering. The faith that teenagers exhibit is the result of what they experience in the home. What is modeled for them by their parents is most important. And the ways that faith and practices of faith impact the everyday, such as reading the Bible and connecting biblical stories with living life on a daily basis, means the difference in their ability to articulate what they believe and how they will live. Will their faith be one that can be stated in words and shown in actions, or will it be decorative, just part of the furniture, easily rearranged, or moved to the background or storage? Rabbi Sandy Eisenberg Sasso believes that children need a language of faith, and it begins with story, because children make sense of their world through narrative and story. Sasso states, "I think such language also comes through ritual and experience. The earliest spiritual experiences that children have often come through routine and ritual that are repeated over and over again. And often when I speak to children and I ask them when do they feel the presence of God or if they could point to a particular experience, they often speak of rituals or moments where they felt very close to their parents and it helped them give expression to what they were feeling." There is an intimacy present when stories are shared. When parents tell or read a Bible story with a child, they're making a commitment of time and space to share in their child's spiritual growth. In the telling and retelling of stories, in the pauses for questions and comments that always arise, parents are making their spiritual life open and near to their child. And in this intimacy of sharing and wondering together, both child and parent grow together spiritually. Children need a language of faith, and it begins with story. Methodist pastor Kenda Creasy Dean contrasts a diner theology of being nice, feeling good about yourself, and saving God for emergencies with a consequential faith, which is far more likely to take root in the rich relational soil of families, congregations, and mentor relationships where young people can see what faithful lives look like and encounter the people who love them enacting a larger story of divine care and hope. Notice what she says about the places where faith is nurtured in children: at home with family, in congregations, and in relationships with adults who model what the life of a Christian looks like. Practicing the faith at home can be done in many ways. John Westerhoff, an Episcopalian religious educator, wrote a very practical book in 1980 titled Bringing Up Children in the Christian Faith. In it, he suggests 5 guidelines for sharing faith with children from birth through childhood. He believes that it is the responsibility of parents and family members to help children grow up with a language and an experience of faith. This is possible when children hear, read, and recall stories from the Bible. Children grow up in their faith when they learn how to pray, at meals and bedtime, and how to offer prayers for others. Westerhoff believes that the Christian faith is first experienced by children when they see how the things they do for others, like listening, helping those in need, caring for someone who needs help, are important activities of service. And children's faith is supported by their participation in the life of a congregation as they learn to worship, celebrate the church seasons, participate in the sacraments, and know that there is a family called church who loves them. Similarly, Daniel Aylshire, a religious educator, wrote this definition of Christian education. Christian education involves those tasks and expressions of ministry that enable people, 1, to learn the Christian story, both ancient and present, 2, to develop the skills they need to act out their faith, 3, to reflect on that story in order to live self-aware to its truth, 4, to nurture the sensitivities they need to live together as a covenant community. The first guideline, learning and telling the story, is the focus of this book. In some ways, it may be the hardest one for many church school teachers and parents. Questions abound. What stories do we read together? Where do we begin? What if a child asks a question I can't answer? If I'm not sure what I believe about the Bible? So how do I read the Bible with my child? Sources for these questions and apprehensions about reading the Bible with children focus on a variety of issues. 1. Previous experience with the Bible. If you grew up attending church school as a child, then you may have a memory bank of favorite stories, possibly stories of familiar biblical characters from the Hebrew Bible. Adam and Eve, Noah, Sarah and Abraham, Ruth and Naomi, David, Esther, Jonah. You may also know a lot of the stories of Jesus, birth, life, teachings, death, and resurrection, and some of the stories of the early church and its leaders, like Paul, Peter, and Timothy. Or you may have forgotten a lot. And if you did not grow up in a religious tradition, or if your family was nominally Christian and attended church only on Christmas and Easter, then your lack of experience with the Bible may be an obstacle to reading it with a child. 2. Knowledge and level of comfort with reading and studying the Bible. If you have a lot of knowledge about biblical stories, then perhaps they are like beads strung on a necklace. Each one is there as a separate entity, and yet are connected because they are important parts of the one story of the Bible, the story of God's love for humankind. If you have continued in your own reading and study of the Bible, both individually and with groups in your congregation, then you have had the chance to grow in your understanding of biblical text and learn more about these stories and how they fit together. Continuing to read and study means that the stories you read as a child or youth may now be understood in new ways. For example, the story of Noah and the flood, a vivid reminder of the relationship between God and God's creation, and the first time we hear the word covenant, can be understood as a universal story of loss and recovery. Who can't relate to that ancient story when you consider your own experiences of loss, recovery, and God's abiding presence? 3. Current challenges and practices. Most homes abound with copies of different Bible translations. Are they on the shelf? Is there a favorite that is read? Do children ever see a parent open or read the Bible? Have you given up on reading it because it is not easily understood? These kinds of experiences in the past and current practices provide the background for considering how to begin again with a child. What in the past experience of parents needs to be held on to and affirmed as a good building block for nurturing a child's growth as a Christian? What in the past needs to be let go so that some new practices of faith can emerge? How can a vocabulary of faith for both parent and child grow as they engage the Bible together? Craig Dykstra, former Vice President of Religion for Lilly Endowment, has written that it is imperative that we help youth recover a religious language that is clear enough to be comprehended by young people, rich enough to be meaningful, concrete enough to relate to the world as it is, and critical enough to keep open the dynamics of inquiry and continuing conversation. One of the ways this religious language is supported is through engagement with the Bible, that holy book that informs us and acts on us. Dykstra has said that God is using the Bible not only to inform us, but to form us and reform us, to shape us into God's own. Kenda Creasy Dean asks this question of parents: do we practice the kind of faith we want our children to have? So before we begin to consider how we read the Bible with our children, it's important to begin with ourselves and our beliefs and assumptions. Why we read the Bible. Take a minute and consider your response to these open-ended sentences. The Bible is. The Bible is not. My own experience with reading the Bible is. When I read the Bible, I struggle with. A question I have about the Bible is. I used to think this, but now. Dykstra's question about how we are being formed, informed, and reformed by our reading of the Bible is a great place to begin. Often I begin a workshop for parents and grandparents with this question: what experiences of reading the Bible did you grow up with as a child? The answers have become fairly predictable. A majority say they grew up with nothing in the home. Some remember a favorite Bible storybook that they read. One or two remember a parent or grandparent who told them Bible stories from memory. Few are able to remember ever seeing a parent reading the Bible. Bible storybooks often include an opening statement about the Bible. These statements provide clues for parents about the hopes and purposes for inviting children into the stories. As you read the following statements, what do you notice? What is explicitly stated about the Bible? What is implicit or assumed? Is there anything missing, or is there something you wished had been said? With a focus on Bible stories and biblical literacy, the Bible Basics Storybook helps kids realize that the Bible is more than a history book and that it's relevant to their lives today. It has been written to help children learn how reading and engaging God's story can help them learn ways to make the world a better place to live for all people. In Growing in God's Love, a Story Bible, the Bible is described as less a book of answers than it is an invitation to wrestle with stories and meanings. Engaging a child's imagination by inviting her to ask questions of a story helps her realize it has meaning for her life today. When a child is invited to pause and hear a story and think about how the story is speaking to his life, then he grows up knowing the Bible will be there throughout his life. He learns that the Bible is not an answer book that he will outgrow, but one that he will grow into as he matures. Shine On, a Story Bible, says in the introduction, "For Christians, the Bible is a rare and precious treasure, an inspiration and guide for our lives. It is a place where we come to listen to God." In describing the variety of kinds of writing contained in the Bible, it says, "These stories present anew the exciting, curious, wonderful account of a God at work in the world with flawed, genuine people. They inspire children and adults to discuss, question, and act in response to the biblical message." In the Children of God Storybook Bible, Desmond Tutu reminds children that God wants us to love others, and that is accomplished when we do three things. Do what is right, be kind to one another, and be friends with God. You will see these teachings and many more in God's stories, which we have gathered here for you and all of God's children. The Candle Read and Share Bible includes a letter to parents in the beginning. What you are holding in your hands is not just a book, it's a unique way to share God's Word with the children in your life, a way to help them come to know God's love, goodness, and faithfulness to us, and to share that good news with others. In the Jesus Storybook Bible, Every Story Whispers His Name, the author addresses two assumptions readers often make about the Bible, that it is a book of rules, or it is a book about heroes. The Bible is most of all a story, one big story, the story of how God loves His children and comes to rescue them. It takes the whole Bible to tell this story, and at the center of the story, there is a baby. Every story in the Bible whispers His name. The Deep Blue Kids Bible, which is the common English Bible translation, includes age-appropriate notes for children. The editors remind the readers that the Bible is more than just a big book. It's a gift to us from God. It's also a gift to us from many people. It took hundreds of years and thousands of people to bring us this gift. And like all good gifts, this Bible is meant to be opened, explored, and enjoyed. It's our hope that you will learn more about God, the Bible, Jesus, faith, and how it all fits into life today. We see how different storybooks introduce the Bible to children as one big story, a book that is a gift to us from God, a love story from God, a collection of different kinds of stories written by people a long time ago, a precious treasure, an inspiration and guide for our lives. It is not a book that gives us all the answers, but rather one that invites us to bring out questions and wonder about what God wants us to learn. It is a place where we come to listen to God. And the Bible helps children make connections between very old stories and living with God's love today. Hearing the Bible stories in relationship with loving parents or family members forms children in faith and helps them develop a language of faith that will grow with them. Church school and midweek programs are great places where children can learn about the Bible and God's love for them, as they have the opportunity to engage in the stories and see the connections the text has to their lives. Even more important than these formal settings for learning are the informal opportunities to hear the stories and wonder about their meanings as they hear the Bible told and read to them at home. Hearing the Bible stories in relationship with loving parents or family members forms children in faith and helps them develop a language of faith and a faith vocabulary that will grow with them. How do we read the Bible with children? A commitment to reading the Bible with children requires that we do so with a critical lens. Bible storybooks seem to share a common canon of stories. Stories with animals or fish, stories of female and male heroes in the Old Testament, and stories of Jesus are always included. When we introduce children to these stories for the first time, we do so knowing that they will continue to hear and read them repeatedly over the course of their childhood if they are active participants in the educational life of a congregation. How the stories are told matters. Just like we choose what stories from our families we share and when we share them, we also need to make this decision when we teach stories from the Bible to our children.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.